First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
No doubt. Time to definitely get in contact with nature, Mother Earth. All right, be back once again with Dr. Alim El-Bey's show. And tonight... we got some guests, and that's going to be coming on in the next half an hour or so. And they're going to build with y'all on the science of MOOR jurisprudence. And I'm going to kick it off basically with some information, as I normally do. And we're going to basically break down, like, for example, tonight's is occult teachings. Well, occult means hidden or out of view or cut from out of view. It also means mystical or mysterious. All right, so. We're going to get into the deeper sciences of MOOR science, as well as also MOOR jurisprudence, in which that jurisprudence, for those who don't know, is like an old Latin, an old Moorish Latin word, in which that means right law or knowledge or skill or foreseeing. All right, so for those that read Sex and Race by J.A. Rogers or Ancient and Moderate Britain, by David MacRitchie, they both speak about the fact that the original Britons were blacks, Moors. And so the Moors also penned the primal books on the subject matter and the disciplines of jurisprudence, you know, which is now used universally, you know, throughout the globe. So jurisprudence is the science which treats positive law, you know, and the philosophy of law. All right, so that's what we're going to get into. We break down some more information right quick. Like, for example, the hierarchy of law. The first order of law is natural law. And so there's, you know, these are universal principles. The universal principles during ancient Kemetic time, or Temere, ancient Temere, was broken down with the principles of Tahuti and his wife, Mayat. All right, they both symbolize, Tahuti symbolized wisdom, Mayat symbolized truth. So they had their own seven principles. They both had, Tahuti had 42 books, Mayat had 42 laws. right? So those principles, those are universal principles, all right? And they so necessarily agree with nature and the state of man that even without observing the inherited maxims, the peace and the happiness of society can never be, you know, would never be preserved without them. You know, in other words, we are able to see, you know, how these laws work in order to maintain peace and happiness within the society. So, and basically, in other words, it becomes common sense and common reasoning, you know, that the knowledge of natural law basically may be attained merely by the light of reason from the facts of their essential agreeableness with the constitution of human nature. So natural law exists regardless of whether it is enacted as positive law. So it exists regardless if we have to write it down. It's just something on which that, based on as they say, Jesus allegorically stated that do unto others as others have them to do unto you. That is the supreme law, you know, basically. You know, so when laws begin to emerge into human consciousness and thought and words and deeds, we come to the next level of law on this planet, you know. And the most fundamental law of all human law has to do with the survival, which is a universal principle, you know. It has to do with human interaction of all kinds. Any relationship, buying, selling, trading, relating in any way, it is based upon the treating or dealing with others the way you would have them or you would like to be treated or dealt with yourself. So this goes into the law of commerce. So after the natural law is the law of commerce. And the law of commerce has been basically in operation since time began, you know, since our very existence on this planet. However, a codified system, you know, in which that we are able to date back to was about maybe 6,000 years old. You know, it came from Sumeria or Babylon or Babylonia, which is Mesopotamia nowadays, which is Iraq and Iran. In which that 6,000 years ago, this system was revealed, you know, and was so complex that it even included receipts, coined money, shopping lists, manifestos, and a postal service with the medium between being in baked clay. So, I mean, this system dates back to that time period, you know, and as basically a derivative of commercial law being removed from natural law, and therefore it's inferior, you know, but next would be after the law of commerce would be common law. You know, this emerges basically in England out of disputes over a portion of the earth and allodium, which is sovereign ownership of land, and was based on common sense. So common law is the law of the earth, you know. However, what they have done, they have taken laws, the laws of commerce, which they have used the forms now, which is international form, the UCC, and transformed that into the law of the earth. All right, this is what they have done. But common law gives rise to the jury system and the many writs and processes which the government have absorbed and statutes, you know, and basically made into rules, regulations, ordinances, codes, statutes, you know, all the processes and, you know, in the court or throughout the court process. So common law procedures was based on the opportunity to face your accuser or the injured party or damaged party in front of witnesses to sort out the problem directly. This process was never intended to include, however, lawyers, attorneys, or judges construing their own law. You know what I'm saying? You know, and as de facto as it is nowadays, as these titles are all based upon the fiction of representation, which can never be the real thing because it represents something. Well, you can't represent yourself because you are yourself. So you can present yourself, but not represent yourself. And they can't represent you either because once they do, you actually become a ward to the state or orphan. In other words, when you have a lawyer or an attorney, I should say, who turns things over, you actually become a ward to the state unless you have a contract in which that you have written up in which that he will only state the things in which that you have put within the contract. That's the way in which that he will have to speak on your behalf to represent you. However, if he's making deals and plea bargains and so forth and so on your behalf, and you really have no concept of what's going on in court, which most of us don't, you know. I mean, for example, when the judge say, do you understand the charges being brought up against you, you would say emphatically no. Number one is the issue of jurisdiction, which jurisdiction can be raised at any time, any given time in a court case. You know, matter of fact, it can be when you before the jury, during the jury trial, and even after the judgment, the issue of jurisdiction can always be raised. And you will want to have sent in your documentation, your affidavits and notices prior to going to court. Your notice of special appearance or restricted appearance, you will want to send that in prior to going to court. Putting them on notice, you know that you are in this kangaroo court. It has no stenographer. It has no one recorded it at the district level, which is the lowest level court, which is not an Article III court. So, when we look at this, we have to understand what's really going on. So after common law comes the government and their laws and legislative regulations, you know, and the republics of the state, so forth and so on. The only laws that the state can create is to allow commerce to flow more efficiently within the state. The only law the central government, United States of America, can create was to allow commerce to flow more efficiently between the states. It was never intended to regulate people, the sovereigns, the free inhabitants. It was never meant to do that. So these are misconceptions, you know. So when we speak about natural law, you know, if you get the Barron's third edition, the way that I broke it down, you can get the Barron's third edition, and it speaks about it basically the same way of natural law. And also in your information that you were sent before court or which that precedes you before going to court, if you have a court matter, I hope that you don't. You know, it would be best to stay out of the court system, you know, and actually to form your own tribunals or court system. As indigenous people, you have the right to do that according to the Declaration of Rights of Indigenous People of the United Nations. It states specifically that you have that right. We get into some of that in a little bit. But you have to make a distinction, denial of corporate status or negative avertment, in which that deals with you being a natural being or natural person, you know, because a natural person is a human being as opposed to an artificial or fictitious person, such as a corporation. So the phrase natural person does not include corporate entities, but the phrase person without qualification may or may not include an artificial person, depending on the context. Thus, the phrase no person in the 14th Amendment Equals Protection Clause has been held to include natural and artificial persons. This is why we can still be classified as 3/5 of a human being, because that is the artificial characteristic in which that, according to Article 1, Section 2 of the Constitution, it says 3/5 person, in which that was a reference to us and to those who are Negroes or African descent under those artificial labels. Negro, black, and colored are artificial labels. Those are labels which that are adjectives. Those are not proper nouns. Africa itself is a continent. The nationality is based on the countries, which there are 53 countries in Africa. The question would be, well, which country you come from and which that you have a nationality, but a continent, all right? This is a continent. So the thing is that when we say that we're African Americans, it's not specific enough. It's a generic term, such as Negro, black, and colored. These are generic terms. Even though an African American can be a proper noun, Negro, black, and colored or not. And the most proper or proper persona, sojourist, that we can be is with the name or title Moor. And how we know that is because these secrets have been given up by the white Shriners and white Masons. When they see the brothers with the feathers on or the sisters with the turbans on, they have stepped to the brothers and sisters and have asked them, are you Moors? Of course, we have said yes. And they said, well, we're glad that you're waking up. Hopefully, y'all can help us with some of the things in which that is transpiring in society today. So, this is what is going on. This is why Obama was put in position. It's because their hand was shown because of the Moorish Renaissance. The new Moors have awakened, and this is what is going on. So, in your documentation, you have to make a distinction between being a natural person and an artificial person. You have to say that you are not 3/5 of a human being, that you're not civilized mortus, which means dead in the eyes of the law, civically, because it's in the civil arena where you would get your remedy. In civil court, you seek remedy for a criminal act. You might win the criminal act, however, to get remedy, you have to go to the civil side. This is where your lawsuits takes place at. Denial of rights. Denial of rights under colorable law. It comes from that. So, this is where we have to be in full life, civically. Okay, we have to state that. All right. Now, this is one of the things in which that they have done in order to put us under under this slave system or this chattel system. When you look at the word slave, you look at the Black's Law Dictionary 4th edition, they specifically say that a slave is a person who is wholly subject to the will of another, one who has no freedom of action, but whose person and service are wholly under the control of another. Now, this is what is going on with us. We're in a state of slavery still. We don't have major factories. We don't make our own socks or underwear. And every time that we do begin to start doing these things on a major level or international level, we sell our factories or items such as FUBU, Cross Colors, Carl Kanai. All right? So we have to begin to start doing things and keeping it going. Look on the Heinz ketchup bottle. you'll see 1800 and something, and they still have this product going to this day, 1867 or something like that, 1857, they still have it going. Unlike, we can't say that we have something that's going like that. It becomes an institution in society. So, 3/5 of a human being is chattel. And we spoke about this before, that chattel is a nice little French word for cattle. And when you look up in Black's Law Dictionary, first edition, it says an article of personal property. That any species of property not amounting to freehold or fee in land. In other words, if you don't have a tie back to land, you're chattel. When you look up the definition of the word moor, it says worth 100 bailiffs, an officer of the court worth 100, you know, worth who summons the court for several shreddings, and who is worth 100 bailiffs. That's the definition of the word moor in the Black's Law Dictionary, fourth edition. Now, when you look up land in the Black's Law Dictionary, the word moors is embedded inside of the definition, showing that with using the name moor, it ties you back to the land. Fee in land. Corporations can't own land. Only the sovereigns, natural inhabitants, free inhabitants can. And it says amount to freehold, so you have to be free. So the term chattels is more comprehensive, basically, than goods, as it includes animated as well as inanimated property. So, when dealing in commerce, could we spoke about that, you will have to do a UCC-1 financial statement in which that shows that you are the secured party creditor and not the debtor, and list all your collateral and all your property as such, and in favor of the secured party creditor. You do a security agreement, private agreement, whole homeless indemnity clause with another collateral listing. You do optional form 90, which is release on lien of real property, in which that you make the DTC, which is the depository trust company. You make them basically the debtor, because this is where all of this is coming from, as far as them taking your birth certificate and putting it on the stock market. The DTC and its subsidiary. So, this is what is going on. And once again, chattel includes animated as well as inanimated property. So you're animated. You have a spirit. You have a soul. You have energy flowing through you. Chi, prana, ki, kahuna mana, Holy Spirit. Whatever term that you want to use, Shekinah, Kundalini, Ra, Jah, Yahweh, Allah, God, whatever name that you want to give to it, it moves you. And what they have done is to attempt to trap God or box God in and to own God via your physical body. They're soul snatchers and soul catchers, because they are soulless. So their goal is to capture souls. Why you think the prison system is called penal system? as compared to the pineal gland. The penal system, and they incarcerate you, just like the soul is incarcerated or incarnated in the physical body. So then they take the soul and the body and put it within incarceration behind bars with white walls around it. Just like the white wall symbolizes the calcification of the pineal gland, in which they themselves don't have access to the soul principle because of the calcification. So the kundalini energy raise up through the 33 vertebrates and the 31 plus 2 nerves, 33 nerves, it can cause spontaneous mankind combustion. And this is the opposition in which that has occurred due to us tampering with the life aspect of DNA and genetics. We're reaping the repercussions on karma for that. But was being chattel or 3/5 of a human being still classified in the Constitution, and we have not denied it and have not put forth any documentation to state that we are not, because we fall up under natural laws, natural beings, or natural persons, which you have that right to state that you do. But since you have not, then you are, as they say, it's just prima facie evidence that you are property. And property needs to have chattel papers, which means records. The evidence of both, which has a monetary obligation to it, and a security interest in the Pacific goods. You know, if a transaction is evident by record, that includes an instrument. And that instrument is your birth certificate. And that's UCC 9-102A. So that is what that is. You know, so we get ready to go, and we'll see if the brother is getting ready to, if he's ready to come on. All right, brother, if you're ready to come on, put your hand up. Peace.
Hello?
Yes, greetings.
Hey, Hotep. I was just checking out what you was just speaking on. I like that. With the 33.
Right.
Powerful information.
Oh, yeah, no doubt, because it symbolizes the fact that they tell you that Jesus Christ died at the age of 33, that Alexander, so-called great, died at the age of 33, or that King Arthur had 12 knights at the round table, in which that once those 31 nerves become alive with the kundalini energy, it goes into the 12 pericranial nerves, which is in the brain, in which that activates the pineal gland, which is at the center of the brain. And those 12 pericranial nerves sit around it. So hence the King Arthur and the 12 knights at the round table, which is also symbolic to Jesus and the 12 disciples at the Last Supper, which is also symbolic to the sun and the 12 zodiac signs. So as above, below, as within, so without.
True.
You know, is a constant reenactment of these forces in play. You know, brother?
Right.
All right.
And also with the Masonic, the 33 degrees of knowledge.
Oh, yeah. Anything. And you got it. You're right. And that's the reason why they use 33.
Right.
Because it symbolizes Jacob's ladder, or those 33 steps, in which that you see angels ascending and descending upon, which is within the ancient Egyptian mythology, is called the Djed, which the word Jedi or the Jedi or Jedi comes from, in which that symbolizes those various colors of the lifesavers, from red to violet, in which that symbolizes the seven chakra system, in which that is superimposed on the endocrine gland, in which that those nerves, those 31 to 33 nerves, spread out from the spinal column and attaches to the various in the body.
Right. So how does that supersede with the Moors praying at a 45-degree angle?
Well, the 45-degree angle symbolizes the cornerstone. Remember,
right.
That the builders refuse will always be the head cornerstone.
Okay.
Bob Marley said that. So,
right.
And that is scripture in which that symbolizes, that 45-degree symbolizes that cornerstone, which actually is symbolic also to Chaim Abiff. You are the Chaim Abiff people who was hit in the head.
Right.
You know, struck by the three ruffians and laid in the north. That's what that is symbolic to.
Okay.
You know, so it's talking about a people who now have amnesia, who do not know themselves, who are not conscious of what is going on, and they are lost for the symbology and the symbolism in which that is all around them.
In other words, like the Honorable Elijah Muhammad spoke about, when people don't have an identity, they don't know self.
Exactly. So that's the whole point. It's time to get back to self. So I appreciate you out.
That's good.
All right.
Okay. Wine.
All right. So this is what's going on, y'all. You know, hopefully y'all understand what I'm talking about here. You know, because, like I said, those chattel papers is your birth certificate. Now, your birth certificate basically is like this. You're worth your weight in gold. That's always been the saying, or old saying, that you are the equivalent to gold. You are gold, black oil, all right? You are the monetary system itself. And what happened is that when they became a de facto government, specifically in 1933, based on the House Joint Resolution 192 by Franklin Delano Roosevelt, he actually have used that instrument actually to remove the gold standard, you know, which that used to back the fiat note that we now currently have, the fiat note, which is actually was a gold certificate then. So you was able to go into a bank and take your money in, which is real currency at that time before 1933, and exchange it for gold, and gold for currency, money. You know, so it has something in which that was backing it. Now it's not backed by anything. Matter of fact, it's worth 2 cents on the dollar, basically. You know, so that means basically if you're making $1, $5, $10, $20, $50, $100, it's 2 cents in order to make the Federal Reserve Bank. All right? So what happens is that your birth certificate, they bonded you at birth, and your mother was the informant. She snitched on you. And then the hospital brought you into, birthed you, just like a ship is birthed, because your body symbolizes a vessel, and brought you to shore. And so now, because you were brought to shore, you need a docket. And so here comes the doctor to dock you. And the dock in which that became is your birth certificate with his docket number on it, which is your state file number, which is also the bond number, which is at the bottom in red. And if you look on the birth certificate, you also will see Midwest Bank Note Company, or one of the bank note companies, in which that shows that that is a actual bond. And you can look up on www.fidelity.com or some other websites in order to verify that if you put in your state file number or your bond number or even your Social Security card front and back, you can actually find out how much you're being traded for on the market. Now, at birth, your bond, which is your birth certificate, is worth, according to the IRS, is worth about $650,000. All right? And it actually goes up to about $1.6 million at birth. And that's based on if you weigh between 5 to 10 pounds. So basically, that's what it meant by you're worth your weight in gold. All right? So that makes us chattel property with chattel papers. Now, when you look at the Now you got to understand who runs the banks. The banking system is ran by the Jews. And what is a bank? The bank is controls the flow of water, which is the current. It controls the water. So it controls immorality and maritime law, the banks, the banksters. And with that comes the Jews referring to the non-Jewish people or person as a Gentile. Hence, the word Gentile is also symbolic to the word genitals. Hence, someone who dwells in their lower nature. But the word that they use is called goyim, or goy for a person, or goyim for the people. And they refer to the people as the heathens or a troop of animals. That's what the word goyim means. It means a troop of animals. All right? It is Jewish slang for chattel or cattle or animals. Now you go to the now you can get this in the new concordance, exhaustive concordance of Bible of 1995. Now if you go to the Ballantine Law Dictionary 1930 and the Black's Law Dictionary on first edition, it speaks about the word monster. And it says, a human being by birth, but in some parts resembling a lower animal. Hence, talking about your lower nature once again. And someone who uses primarily the reptilian portion of their brain, which is basically what controls the first and second chakras. And so when you're operating from that, you know, it is very easy to become demonically possessed by spirits, as well as also be a psychopath or sociopath. Because your whole mechanism is based on survival. It's not based on anything of higher consciousness. It's based on the lower consciousness, which is the devil or the double. And the double is the lower self, which reflects the higher self. So the lower self is the double of the higher self. So it says that the word monster is a human being by birth. A human being or offspring not having the shape of mankind, which cannot be heir to any land. Which cannot be heir to any land. So these are human beings by birth, but they can't be heirs to any land. Of course not. If you're being classified as 3/5 of a human being, which is a subhuman, which is a monster, then you have no land connection. So hence, the reason why they was able to give you Negro, Black, and Colored as the adjectives. So when you look at the word goods, as with the word chattel, now you go to Black's Law Dictionary 6th edition, basically goods is all things which are movable at the time of identification to the contract for sale, investment securities, and things in action. Also includes the unborn young of animals. The unborn young of animals. So no, all things which are movable, which is i.e. equal to newborn children. So hence the reason why there's been a rash taking of the children by social services, DSS, in the United States as well as in Canada. Because they're goods, and the parents gave them up at birth through via the birth certificate. Now, there's ways in order to protect your autograph, your signature, and that's with UCC 1-103.6, UCC 1-308, all rights reserved without prejudice. So if you sign any contract, always sign with that protection, because that means now you go into a contract knowingly. And that you have the right in order to violate that contract and break that contract or breach that contract if you find that there was anything which that was not disclosed to you. In other words, what was not written in a fine print. Well, all of a sudden just came out of nowhere and they just claiming that they're going to increase things. No, you don't have to. You have the right to protect your property and your assets at all times. which is i.e. yourself. The most important thing you can do is declare your nationality, because your nationality puts you back with the land tie. It puts you back into connection with natural law. Once again, the most important thing you can do is declare your nationality, land tie, natural law, which makes you above the law, which makes you above the law of commerce, which makes you above common law. Hence, it makes you the sovereign, because when I see you, I see the Father. When you see me, you see the Father. In other words, I see you now as God. You're no longer an animal. You are your higher self. You're no longer the lower self. You are now your higher self. But it says, no, all things which are movable equals the newborns. At the time, the security interest attaches, which is the birth certificate. It equals birth. And execution and registration of the birth document certificate, which is identification to the contract, it equals newborns, footprints, and the informer, which is the mother's signature. The contract equals the birth certificate. Things in action equals the human fetus. Newborn babies, unborn young of animals equals human fetuses. According to Strong's Concordian's Bible, and Gohem equals animals. According to the Jewish Encyclopedia, in Gentile, the Gentile is a beast. See the Phil Warehouse receipts. Go to your Black's Law Dictionary and look up on Phil Warehouse receipts and identification of goods, Gentile and Gohem. Go to these particular books. So this is what we're being seen as, and this is why we are the undesirables on the planet Earth. In India, we call the Sutra the untouchables. Here in the United States, we are second and third class citizens, when we actually are A1 or truth 1A citizens. In other words, we have the highest classification of citizenship here. We are the original Americans. And matter of fact, when you look up the word America, according to Webster Universal Dictionary, 1933, and also 1937, specifically says Aboriginal inhabitants, copper-colored natives, founded here prior to the European invasion or the settlement of the Europeans. The original application of the name is Meru. Meru, which is the same word as the word Moor. You go and do some research on that, and you see what I'm saying is the truth. I have no reason to lie. This is research. The book you can get is called Return of the Serpents of Wisdom by Mark Amaro Pinkham. All right. So we're gonna bring the brother on in. Peace.
Islam.
You ready out?
Islam, this brother Sheikh Kareem, yourself, Corner Gay Bay.
All right.
How you doing,
yes,
brother?
All right, I'm going to bring the other brother on in, too. You ready?
Yes, sir.
Peace. Islam. All right, you ready?
Yes, sir.
All right, well, they ready for you. Hit them up,
Islam, this brother Kareem Yusuf Corner Gate Bay from the Moor Sinai Temple, the Divine National Movement Incorporated number 13, the Moorish American National Republic. And I got a brother with me, brother. Introduce yourself, brother.
Yeah, this is Brother Tunde Sadat Rael, also with the Moor Sinai Temple, Divine and National Movement in North America Incorporated number 13, Moorish American National Republic. Islam to everybody that's on the line. Peace to y'all.
All right.
Yeah, we have
what you have for us.
Listen.
Oh yeah, we here. What you have for us tonight?
where we're having a meeting. You can almost say that it's another great convention coming up in February. February 19th. Am I correct, Sheikh?
Yes, sir. February 19th. It's going to be held in. Yeah, February 19th is going to be held at the Fort Greene Senior Citizen Council building in Brooklyn, New York. The address is 966 Fulton Street. We having the Grand Sheikh Joe Bratton Bey come down to demonstrate to the Moors the divine as well as the national side of the movement. We inviting all the Moors to come because we have recently was granted full faith and credit. And if you study the Constitution, that's granted to nations or states. So we able to operate and have our Moorish courts in each republic. So the Grand Sheikh is going to come down to demonstrate and show the documentation that we was granted full faith and credit, and now we have our own Moorish court. So we don't have to deal with the foreign jurisdiction no more. We could deal with our own jurisdiction that is recognized. As well, he's going to demonstrate we have certificate of motor carriages to distribute to our citizens. So far as like a lot of us Moors, we've been navigating the way the Patriots been navigating. Far as the rights to travel, which is definitely constitutional, but the Prophet Nawajir Ali, he set up the Vast Express Trust, which is a common law trust, which is known as the Moor Science Temple. So what we do is that, when you have a common law trust, you're able to put property under that common law trust for it to be protected. And we know the Prophet Nawajir Ali said, put everything in my name or do everything in my name. So what we do, we put your conveyances under the trust, under the Prophet, and we distribute certificate of motor carriages, and we get corporate tags because that's a corporate vehicle, a corporate motor conveyance. So then now when you have the Romans who may stop you or check your plates, it's not going to be in your name. It's going to be under the Prophet's name. And since we able to distribute certificate of motor carriages, that car's in the jurisdiction of the Prophet Nawajir Ali, that vehicle. So if they ticket that vehicle or anything, they're not ticketing you because you're the resident agent that's able to operate that motor conveyance, but it's under the temple, under that corporation. And since they have no jurisdiction hiding the Prophet, they can't ticket the Prophet. So our corporation, which is the Muslim Temple, the Divine National Incorporated Number 13, the Moorish American National Republic, would deal with their corporation pertaining to that issue. But since you're the resident agent that's able to operate that conveyance, it don't have nothing to do with you. It's dealing with the corporation. So that's how we navigate in this day and time when you're dealing with the traveling issue. And then, we also able to distribute passports that we have that is recognized by the government, and that we just got to create a country code. And once you create the country code, we'll be able to distribute Moorish passports as well for our citizens. So the Grand Sheikh, Joel Bratton Bey, he wants to come down and demonstrate and show this to the Moors because, the Prophet already won the victory. He's already won. So there are a lot of ways things we've been doing things. We could do things differently now, operating from our own jurisdiction. And I don't know if the brother Tunde Sadara L would like to add on.
Yeah, most definitely. When you do your research on the Prophet Nawajir Ali, and when you research after he made his transition, you can see that the Moorish Science Temple was infiltrated by subversive operators. And what happened during that period was that a lot of the Moorish Science Temple started to be incorporated under 501c3s. So they began to operate like churches, and they weren't really dealing with the national side. You still see that today. A lot of Moorish Science Temples are operating like churches, and they're not dealing with the national side. But when you do your research on the Prophet Nawajir Ali, when he went to the Pan American Conference in Havana, Cuba in 1928, he received that mandate. And when he came back here in the Americas, he basically claimed the Americas and he set up that religious corporation. But once again, when you look at that Quran questions for Moorish children, look at the back of that document, look at the back of that pamphlet that you get. On the bottom, when you read it, It says our authority, page 579, State of Illinois. Corporation, religious affidavit organization form number 1099. When you go to the bottom, it says Herds Revive Statute. You have religious corporations out there, but they're not under the Herds Revive Statute. The only other organization, large organization, that's under the Herds Revive Statute is the Vatican. These Moor Science temples that are out here, they're not under the Herds Revive Statute. That Herds Revive Statute, which allows you to operate your organization as a nation and takes you out of the jurisdiction of these corporate banks that you were mentioning, Brother Alim, you know, that are selling your birth certificate on the market like hotcakes because you're a bond, you're chattel property. So when slavery ended, when the Emancipation Proclamation was passed and slavery ended, so-called slavery ended, a lot of our people thought that once the chains were off, that it was over. And when I say I'm saying our people, but also the Albion, they were enslaved. They were the original slaves. They thought the same thing as well. But what the private banks and the corporations did was they just created a monetary system where your birth certificate serves as a bond, so you're still chattel property. You're still being sold on the market, and today it's still going on, and our people don't even know it. So a lot of Moorish Americans who are members and citizens of Moorish Science Temples don't know that, yes, you claim your nationality, you're a Moorish American, but you're a Moorish American who's still in the status of property. You're still that artificial person because you never did anything to correct the birth certificate. And a beautiful thing about Temple Number 13, Divine and National Movement, National Republic out of Baltimore, was that what they did was they followed up where the Dingell brothers left off at in regards to creating a Bureau of Vital Statistics, in which you get an affidavit of live birth, and they notify and correct that birth certificate and let them know that you're not that chattel individual. This is now your birth certificate, this last affidavit of live birth. What they also instruct is when you go through the courses is the naturalization process. This has been big controversy, you know, in regards to whether Moors should be naturalized, because most Moors say, we shouldn't be naturalized. We're indigenous to this land. It's in our DNA. True indeed. You're correct. We are indigenous to this land. We're the oldest people. We're descendants of the mound builders. And that's one of the reasons why the prophet was able to obtain the mandate, because of his relationship with the Washita. He was his cousins with the empress, and his DNA and his bloodline shows that he is, you know, he's the supreme ruler of this land. When you see that 1099 form, you see that official certified copy from 1928, you'll see that R on the bottom, upside down, and the Grand Sheik Joe Bratton Bay is going to bring that document. When you look in the Black's Law Dictionary, it states that he was the supreme ruler of the land. So he was genius in what he did, because when he set up that vast express trust, guess what? We are the prophet's children. The prophet is one with Allah. So we are his beneficiaries. You have trustees, you have beneficiaries. So with him setting up his vast express trust, basically this land is ours. That's basically by him making that statement, and everybody at that Havana-Cuba conference agreed with it. He was recognized, and internationally. So when he did it, the Moorish Science Temple of America got international and national recognition. But when you go under the subject of servitude, when you're a captive of war, when you're not in your proper person, you are considered an alien. Legally, it's a legal term. Even if you're on your own land, you are considered an alien. You're not in your proper status, and you're a subject, you're a slave, you're a captive of war. So therefore, you have to go through the naturalization process. And Noble Dr. Lee talks about it in the Divine Warning naturalization process. Proclaim your nationality. So on and so forth. So when you understand that, and then when he breaks down Act 6, he talks about from 1779 to 1865. Moors, a lot of time we look at history, we said, you know, we the Moors, we ruled the seven seas, we had the European enslaved. That's true. So during the time of 1700s and 1800s, there were Moors who didn't have to go through this process because they weren't born into slavery. Like a lot of Moors bring up the Sunji Free Moor Act. That's correct. There's a lot of cases. Abdul Rahman, who was released. He was held captive and then he was released. He knew who he was. But today, we're all born in bondage by way of that birth certificate. So the naturalization process is a way of us, the Hebrew Muslims, recording who we are and getting an affidavit of live birth to separate yourself from that straw man. That's what needs to happen. And on top of that, how else are you going to come into the constitutional fold? When you read the Declaration of Independence, Article 1, Section 8, Moors always teach that, you know, the Moors gave us the first seven articles of the Constitution, which is true. But what is the first article? The first article talks about what? Establish a uniform rule of naturalization. Leviticus chapter 25, verse 10, talks about being in bondage for 6 years and being released on what? The seventh year. So there's that number seven again. So as Hebrew Muslims, we have to go through this process to be de jure and to be right and exact, to be part and parcel with this government. That's the piece that we've been left out, because Moors study law, but when it comes to the legal term of an alien, they thinking that the naturalization process is the one that's for people who come from another country. That's not the naturalization process. We're talking about the naturalization process based on Mosaic law, the Hebrew code. It's on a Liberty Bell. In Philadelphia, liberty represents freedom. That Liberty Bell represents freedom. So we have to go through this process so that we can be part and parcel of this government and so that we can, once again, be free from bondage, that bondage that we're talking about from these private banks and these corporations. And also with the naturalization process, I'm going to let the brother Kareem Cornegay-Bay break down what the Dingell brothers did in 1940 as far as establishing the Bureau of Vital Statistics.
All right. Hold on. Before we get to that, there was a question in the chat room.
Okay.
By M7. He asked the question, please present us with some reference to the conference. It says no one has been able to show this. And I think it's a conference in which that he's talking about, a convention in which that he's talking about, is the one from 1928.
Right. Yeah, the information that most Moors receive comes by way of the Moor Science Temple in regards to, and that's how I was educated on the Havana-Cuba Conference. And I think the issue with the Havana-Cuba Conference is that when a lot of people research it, they don't see Noble Drew Ali's name as one of the attendants. And what was told was that he didn't use his name, Noble Drew Ali. So that's one of the concerns in regards to Noble Drew Ali attending the Havana-Cuba Conference. But the thing about what Noble Drew Ali did was that regardless of that, he still was able to set up that Religious Corporations Act on the Herzl-Ravai statute. And he set up a vast press trust in Cook County, Illinois. So therefore, for him to be able to establish that, he had to have some type of, you know, authority to set up something of that magnitude. And one thing people have to understand is that Noble Drew Ali was an adept. So from the time he came on his plane, even to now, the man is very much a mystery. So what we're doing today is doing research and putting the pieces together. You know, his parents were educated by a Sufi adept by the name of Jamal Afghani.
Right.
And Noble Drew Ali also was in the presence of the Kitiwa Society. It was a Cherokee brotherhood, fraternal brotherhood. The brother also frequented the Moor Zionist Temple. So,
right.
Also, when you know, as you broke down a lot of your lectures, when you break down the Circle 7 Quran, the Moor Science Temple, you know, those books are comprised of basically three books. Those are adept books. There's no way those books, you don't find those books just lying on the sidewalk. You had to have been initiated through some type of order to have access to that information, and the prophet never said he wrote it. So, you know, to anybody who's listening to the chat room, you know, in order for you to really understand what the prophet brought, sometimes you have to study some of these schools of thought yourself, such as Sufism, you know, studying the Kabbalah, Masonry. You know, a lot of people, you know, it's controversial, but the man obviously went through certain schools of thought, and it was divinely placed upon him by the great God Allah to take that path. You know, he was definitely initiated. When you read the language, you talk about the lower self and the higher self, and understand where that comes from. You know, once again, that's, you know, esoteric material from Sufism.
Right.
So, when you study his history, if you don't study that type of knowledge, and those type of crafts, it's going to be hard for you to really comprehend what the man was saying. And I think that's what is the problem. A lot of people just take what he wrote, you know, for face value. But you have to kind of decode the information. You know, you look at some of his stance he's taking when he's standing on the square, when he's putting his hand over his heart, you know, when he's standing on the number nine. You know, those are stances of adepts. Those are the stances of Sufi masters. You know, the term noble, you know, during that time, a lot of people, you know, it's controversial, but if you wasn't going through the shrine, a lot of people couldn't have that term as noble, you know, or the nobility. So today we're still doing a lot of research as far as the prophet's life, because he was a mystery. But if you study that type of information, you understand what he did better. But once again, as far as the Pan American Conference, there's still a lot of research being done on that, because we haven't seen his name, and it's possible he could have went under a different name. But what we do know is that when he came to Chicago, Cook County, he was able to set up that vast express trust. We do have the proof of that. And he was able to do it under the Herzl Vaz statue. And after he did what he did, the Vatican copied him. And if you do any research in the Vatican, you know, not to bring any negativity to the conversation, but if you notice, some of those Catholic priests don't go to jail, because when they do some of their heinous acts, because they're not subject, they're not under the jurisdiction.
Right, religious protection.
Exactly. You know, so the prophet used ecclesiastical law in regards to what he did. So
Islam?
Yeah, Islam.
Yeah. Islam, and what the brother's saying, like, yeah, that's doing a pre-stablical body that they have no jurisdiction over. Because the prophet, he's the sovereign of the land, and we know we is adopted children. So we got to come under the divine authority of the Honorable Prophet Noble Drew Ali, so we can navigate, you know, as Moors properly. And with the brothers going into the naturalization process, when you read the Hebrew Mosaic Law, which on March 31st, 1865, was brought to the Senate, it was a debate with a senator by the name of excuse me.
Yeah, it was Senator Harlan from Iowa. He was the Rosicrucian.
Yeah, Senator Harlan and Salisbury, and they said the only remaining law was the Hebrew Mosaic Code. And it says in the remarks, he said, in this connection, that the Levitical Code and the Hebrew law contains a provision of naturalization of foreigners, captives of war, or voluntary immigrants. We fought under captives of war. So the process, if you was in a bond man or a bond woman for 6 years, for the seventh year, you had to be set free. You had to be given compensation for you being held as a slave, or, you know, being a bondman. You had to be given compensation, but go back to Leviticus 25:10. So this was the process. So what we do is that we have a naturalization process. We have a naturalization process, but it's not under the 14th Amendment. It's under the Hebrew Mosaic Code. So this naturalization process that was referred to on March 31st, 1864, is not talking about the 14th Amendment, because the 14th Amendment was not even here yet. It wasn't here until 1868. So what process is he talking about when they mention the naturalization process? The process he's talking about is the Hebrew Mosaic Code. So we don't understand that the prophet, he's affirming in the Divine Constitution to Act 6. In Act 6, like the brother state, it states that we was held from 1779 to 1865. But what took place in 1865?
Oh.
A lot of Moors deal with 1779, when we were stripped of our birthright nationality in 6 Chestnut Street, and stripped of our nationality and birthright. But then when it comes to 1865, nobody wanna speak about what took place. What was the policy of freedom that freed the Moors during that time? And that was dealing with the proclamation, with the 4 proclamations of Abraham Lincoln
with the 13th Amendment in 20 sections, which the Hebrew must be a code in layman's terms. So we got to understand that that would be a permanent part of the Constitution, made permanent part of the Constitution, December 15, 1862, and it was written into law on February 1st, 1865. So it is the law of the land. So we got to understand that during that time when the North and the South was warring with one another during the Civil War, the South came out of the Union unlawfully. And when the North won, for order for the South to come back into the Union, they had to take an oath of amnesty and reconstruction to come back into the Union. One of the generals is very known for this, is General Lee. He had to take an oath of amnesty to come back into the Union State Republic. So at that time, it was either those who were out of the Union, which was the South, and the slaves had to take that oath to come back, but not the North. But presently, since we born under that 14th Amendment, which is that birth certificate, would make us title property, we all have to take that oath to come back into the Union. That's why the prophet said we have to come back as a constitutional full of things. He mentioned it, but he didn't tell us what was the whole process, because the Muslim symbol is a divine and national movement, and movement is something that's progressive and keeps on going. So our Grand Sheik Richardson Digwell at that time understood this. And at that time, it was three masters that was teaching this policy of freedom, which was German Bey, Grand Sheik German Bey, Richardson Digwell, and his brother Timothy Digwell. These are the three masters that were teaching this policy of freedom. So this is the policy of freedom that the Moors got to wake up to, that you have to take the oath of amnesty and reconstruction to come back into the Union. That was the law. So that's
right.
The process of coming. Yes,
now, that's that deep, because that correlates to what we was talking about, how the Jews referred to those who, as they referred to as non-Jewish persons, as Gentiles or the Goyim. And you're saying that we have to come back, naturalize under the Hebrew Mosaic laws.
Yes, sir.
That correlates to the fact of not having to be referred to any longer as a Goyim. Or as a goy,
exactly.
You know, which as an animal or chattel property or three-fifths of a person, which is a subhuman, a monster.
That's right.
Yes.
So who just uses their lower nature. So I got you, and that people, y'all better understand what these brothers are talking about. All right? Let me go into something, too, that we've been building on. Let me go a little bit further for that question which that the brother asked in the chat room. Prophet Noble Ali, you get his oral traditions and prophecies. He says that I did not tell anyone where I was born or who my parents were, because I did not want people to make a shrine out to the place or make over my parents like was done with Joseph and Mary. That's an allegory. He was stating the fact, basically, is that his mother, this is what we have to come into the understanding, that his mother and father was part of the landmark case, the United States versus the heirs of Henry Turner, or Tunica, you know, which is case 32, United States Appellate Court, 1850. And the heirs of Henry Turner versus the United States, case 191, in which that they showed that they actually are the owners of over 30 million acres of land throughout the United States and into Canada, North America. And so Prophet Noble Dr. Ali was the fifth prince of the Maison de Rouge over that particular land grant. And so he was the fifth prince. This is why he said that, this is why Noble Dr. Ali made the statement that he was five times stronger than he ever been, because that was symbolic, once again, to the allegory of the fact of him being the fifth prince. And so this is what we have to understand when it comes to this. And so even without the conference or the convention documents of 1928, his lineage bears and proves the United States Supreme Court case laws that his mother, Eliza Turner, was part of that landmark case, that his father, John Quitman, or John Drew, was part of that landmark case.
Exactly.
You know. And that they won back the over 68,883 acres of land. And they was going to go, actually, which that was just the northern portion of Louisiana, but actually it went into the whole 30 million acres and more, you know. So know, these are just some things in which that, you know, I wanted to help clear up also. So please continue, y'all.
I mean, and the camelback off of that, if he'd have went to the conference, he just would have been notifying the nations of what he was going to do.
Right.
He wouldn't have been going to the conference to ask for permission or anything because, like you mentioned, it's in his bloodline. He was the fifth prince.
Right. He says this is what it says in the oral traditions and prophecies, that Prophet Nobadrali said, I am the fifth and the last prophet, and I am five times more powerful than I was before.
Mm.
So whenever you go and see, as you were saying, that he's the cousin to Vediasi Tierra, Tonika Washito Gaston El-Bey, you know, the empress, you would see that he is the fifth marquis of De Maison Rouge. He was the fifth prince. So, you know, this is the way that was encoded by him saying that, you know, and I just want to make that clear, that even without the convention, we have enough proof to show forth who he was.
Islam,
and that's why it's important for a lot of us more to get together with this information that you're presenting, and which I always have been reading upon, and also other Moors who are adept at other history. Like I said, you know, the man's large part of his life is definitely is a mystery, and we're putting a lot of information together now. And like you said, that information is allegorical, so I think a lot of times what throws our people off is that when you don't study that type of information and then you see an allegorical statement, you get lost. But we have to know how to decode. We have to know how to decode this information, because that's how adepts move. The information was allegorical. When you read that, when you read the Quran questions for Moorish Americans, that book is allegorical. But if you, me and the brother Kareem was building upon before, we're both for us studying masonry and studying other adept information. If you ever had your hand on a catechism book, is written almost the same format, where it gives you questions and you have to, you know, get the correct understanding and answer from it. So this is an important piece when dealing with the prophet. And, you know, the prophet definitely was sent to us by the great God Allah. And we have to understand, as Moors, we have to be upright, righteous, and cultured Moors. You know, a lot of times people try to put a negative brand on Moors, but without a doubt, from the time the Prophet came on the scene to now, nobody has been trying, no other groups, no other type of movements have been trying to get people out of the bondage of these banking cartels and the corporations than the Moors. So anybody who's against that is either just straight mentally insane or agent themselves for the corporate government and these private banksters.
Well, but this is what I said during the SETI debate. There's nothing worse than a slave with an ego.
Right. Right.
And that's what's going on. We have slaves that have big egos.
Right.
And these egos have to be slayed. And the only way it can be slayed is with the truth.
That's right.
You know, and Allah's truth. So by us bearing witness to what's going on, they can't defeat the truth no matter what they do. They'll fall by the wayside. They fall into the ditch in which that they have made. You know, we just keep it moving. And that's what's going to happen. That's what's been going on for the last 10, 15 years of the Moorish Renaissance.
That's right.
And that's why us Moors, we got to come together as one, and we got to be moving as one. We all elves and bays. We all carry these noble titles. We all family. There's one prophet and one temple, one more sign temple. So we all one. So we got to get caught up. We got to stop being caught up in this division amongst each other and move together as one and start being the nobles that we really are. And that's the purpose of Grand Sheik is coming down, is to show that we already got everything to operate a government. We already got everything operated government, but we're not claiming that we got the answers. That's why we're calling for all y'all Moors with these lawful and legal minds to come aboard and come under the authority of the Prophet, and let's move this thing like it's supposed to be moved. We got the foundation over here for the things that we're able to do as a nation, but we asking for the Moors to come over, because we're not claiming that we got all the answers by no means. And we know it's a lot of wise Moors out here that got a lot of good information, a lot of know how to do a lot of things. So now we don't have to go in any court and be given motions and stuff for permission. We can execute judgments from our court, which is the man's, and we can do everything from our own jurisdiction. So we're asking for the Moors to come under the prophet's jurisdiction, under the 13th Amendment and 26th in these proclamations, and let's move together as one. Because the victory is already won already. The prophet got the victory already. So we got to just come with this divine authority. And that's why, too, in the 1940s, Ramsey Richard Dickel F. what they call the Morris National Bureau of Vital Statistics. He set this up in the 1940s, and when he met with a general in the Pentagon named General Hershey and General Schwartz. And the reason he went to the military, because when you understand the proclamation, they were to recognize and maintain our freedom at all times. They was our protectors when we was emancipated under the Emancipated Proclamations of Abraham Lincoln, which became, you know, permanent parts of the Constitution. According to the proclamation, they put to recognize and maintain our freedom. So he went to them, and they have all control of all vital records throughout this country. And at first when he went to them, they denied him. But the prophet said, I give you two things to save yourself. And he held up the Circle 7 Quran and the questionnaire. So they asked that they needed an affidavit for them to establish the Most National Bureau of Vital Statistics. So you know what the Grand Chief of Justice Dickel L and his brother did? They came and brought the questionnaire for Morris children, because on the back of it, about authority, that's an affidavit. And I say it was able to establish the Morris National Bureau of Vital Statistics for all Moors to record themselves under our own jurisdiction. And when you read Nehemiah 7, the children of Israel had to be recorded when they was in Babylon according to their own genealogy. So that same process that the children of Israel have to do is what we have to do to this day, because we are for the children. We are of the children of Israel, because the prophet in the questionnaire, he asked one of the questions, name some of the great fathers through which Jesus came, and it states, you know, Abraham, Boaz, Baruch, Jesse, King David, Solomon, Hezekiah, Joseph, by Mary, and wasn't they Hebrews? Wasn't they from the children of Israel? So the prophet said, our forefathers are without a doubt a contradiction. So if they were Hebrews, then we Hebrew. So we Hebrew Muslim. And that's how we fought under that Levitical code that's mentioned in Leviticus 25:10. That's why we have to go through this process. It's not that when we're saying that according to black law, an alien is one who is an alien, or someone who's a foreigner is dealing with jurisdiction. And what's funny, we read the Dred Scott case, it states that so-called blacks were never citizens, because they was never naturalized. And the funny thing about that, we again know that the 14th Amendment was not yet here. So that process under the 14th Amendment, when we talk about naturalization, a lot of Moors get uncomfortable with that word, but we're not referring to the 14th Amendment. We're referring to the Hebrew Mosaic Code, because we are the Hebrews. And we have to understand and bear witness to that. So that's the process that Grand Chief Richard Dickel L and his brother Timothy Dickel L did when they established this Morris Bureau of Vital Statistics, and that he was the first one to be recognized as a Moroccan born in America in the federal government, and he was one of the first ones to be classified as white on his driver's license. That in Baltimore, they had to take the race designation off because of what he had done. Because, you know, we as Moors understand that white is a social status, as a status, and has nothing to do with your race or your nationality. But we are truly a free white person. That's what the prophet said, you know, God means purity, purity means white, and the rule of the land. Because that's our social, that's our status. So this was the purpose of him to select, establish the Moors National Bureau of Statistics. And we got to understand, too, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad in the 1940s, he went to jail because he refused to be drafted into the military. At the same time, they tried to do the same thing to Grand Chief Richard Dickel L, but they could not do it to him because he was not under their jurisdiction. So the funny thing about it, we know that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was a member of the Mosaic Temple and left and started the Nation of Islam. But at that time frame when he was went into jail for not going to military service, they tried to do the same thing to Grand Chief Richard Dickel L at that same time and could not do it. They could not do it because he was under his own jurisdiction, which is the Morris National Bureau of Vital Statistics. So we got to take, you know, we got to really pay that attention. And if we have what they call a
if brothers want to check this out and sisters want to check this out, it's 147. It says, when can you find the information of this group? This style depicts that every other country, the individual was when he entered into the military. However, he did not have to serve because he was a Moor. It was at this time he was the first person to be registered with the federal government as a Moroccan born in America, therefore establishing the most natural Bible of statistics for all Moors to register and to follow his example. So this is set up for us, and that's what we got to do. So with that, I say peace. I don't know if Brother Commissioner Darrell would like to elaborate on it.
Oh, most definitely. I want to just camelback and just state that, you know, I just want the Moors to know and all our people to understand that.
Any questions, definitely call in. The number is 626-414-3535. That's 626-414-3535. All right. Brother Kareem, you want to continue?
Yeah, Islam. Yeah, and I know a lot of our brothers and sisters, the Moors who studious in the law, they may be saying, well, how's that, you know, law when in 1861, you know, it was Sindad without day and Congress was not a lawful body at that time. But one thing we got to understand that a lot of us Moors, we straight after you guys, who we know nothing of, and adopted a lot of the patriot concepts, who are the sons and daughters of the Knights of Columbus and the Ku Klux Klan. So they created certain ideas that a lot of Moors adopted because they don't want you to know that the policy of freedom that actually freed you was the Proclamation of Abraham Lincoln, the 13th Amendment, the 26th, which was an executive order. Now, how we can show and prove that Congress was a lawful body at that time, we understand that the Union was established in 1774 under the Articles of Association, and the Union consists of 35 Moors and 20 European sons. The Union was made perpetual by the Articles of Confederation in 1778, and it was made a more perfect Constitution of the United States in 1787. Now, only Congress has authority to admit new states into the Union, and thus Congress is the only one who could put states out of the Union when you read Article 4, Section 3, in part. So the South was never lawfully out of the Union. The Southern states was never lawfully out of the Union. To make note that because the Union being perpetual, the Constitution of 1787 was not a replacement of the Articles of Confederation. It was only the continuation of it. So the Articles of Confederation, as it is written, Constitution still exists to this very day. So that means that, you know, we still could use all four constitutions. They all basically one document, including with the treaty, because the treaty is supreme law of the land. So we could use all those documents as one. The Articles of Confederation, as it's written, the Constitution still exists to this very day. I would like to call your attention to Article 10 of the Articles of Confederation. The committee of the states and any non-states of them have the authority to execute the power of Congress when Congress is in recess. During the Civil War, 25 of the state legislators of the Union were not in rebellion, and 9 of the state legislators were of the original 13 states. That was New Hampshire, Rhode Island, Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Delaware, Maryland, and Massachusetts. And we had 6 of the other 16 was basically California, Kansas, and so forth. Now, Tennessee and Louisiana were returned into the Union under military control. The territories in Nevada and West Virginia was admitted as new states in the Union during the Civil War. It says, if Congress no longer exists as a lawful constitutional body in 1861, then West Virginia and Nevada are not lawful Union states even to this very day, which is not documented anywhere in the U.S. government. So we understand that they're the ones that only have the power to take states out of the Union and put states into the Union. During 1861, West Virginia and Nevada were admitted into the Union, and they're still lawful these Union states to this very day. There's nowhere documented anywhere in the U.S. government that they were not. So if you see Congress did lawfully exist as a constitutional body during that time, Now, pertaining to the executive power of the president during the Civil War, I would like to call your attention to the Constitution of 1787, Article 4, Section 4. The state of the Union had to protect against invasion. President Abraham Lincoln prevented the invasion of England and France during the Civil War with the help of Alexander II, who was a Czar of Russia at the time, because during that time they tried to invade United States of America during that time, and Alexander II of Russia, helped protect France from England for coming into America during that time. When you read the Constitution, Article 4, Section 4, it talks about invasion, it talks about domestic violence. It says, and the State of the Union had to protect against domestic violence, which is the abuse of force at home, and the case would be the Civil War. So during that time, during domestic violence, according to that article, Section 4, Clause 4, it talks about, abuse and domestic violence. So during that time, will be recognized as the Civil War, because that was domestic violence, that was at home. When you read it in part, it says the application of legislative or the executive when the legislator cannot be convened. For those of you who still believe that Congress no longer exists as a lawful constitutional body in 1861, President Lincoln had the authority to issue executive order. The reason that this execute executive order is when legislative cannot be convened, the application of the executive must be protected. The State of the Union, according to the Constitution, 1788. So President Abraham Lincoln had full authority to execute executive order that was necessary during the time of rebellion. So his executive order was definitely according to the law, according to when you read that, legislative cannot be convened, the application of executive must protect the States of the Union. So during the Civil War, when it was domestic violence, he had the authority to bring about executive order, which is today known as the proclamation, the four proclamations, the 13th Amendment 20 section. So this is law, more than we got to do the knowledge of this. And the patriot information is some good information, but you understand who the sons and daughters of these patriots were and what was their true purpose. And with that, I just want to say peace. Islam?
Islam. Peace, peace.
Peace.
And also, I would like to read a document by Justice Curtis in 1857. States that the Constitution was ordained and established by the people of the United States through the action in each state of those persons who were qualified by its law to act therein in behalf of themselves and all other citizens of the state. In some of the states, we've seen Moorish persons were among those qualified by law to act on the subject. These Moorish persons were not only included in their body of the people of the United States by whom the Constitution was ordained and established, but in at least five of the states, they had the power to act and doubtless did act by their suffrages upon the question of its adoption. So this document breaks down Moors being part in creating this process of this government and being part of this Constitution from 1857.
Excellent. Yeah. Well, I mean, that's the type of information which that the people need in order to verify, because right now we have a lot of people on which that are straddling the fence. They don't know what to do because there's so many fragments and fractions of the Moorish movement. And they want to see unification, but they don't know where it's coming from or how it's going to get started. And so a lot of them just play the background and stay back, until they can see somebody, putting together and doing something in which that they can relate to. And what happened is that by giving more information, and the more information that a person have, the more they're able to make an intellectual decision and choice on what they really want to do. And like we said earlier, nationality or naturalization is the call of the day. That's something on which that we all need to do, is tie ourselves back to land. And in particular, this land as being the original inhabitants or free inhabitants, And so in a lot of ways, we have to really come to grips, with our decision on if we're going to stay and Negro status are 3/5 of a human being, or if we going to come into full life, you know, and be 5/5, a whole being. And that's the issue in which that is going on. I don't see it as being an issue per se, because I've already done these things. However, for those in which that are still straddling the fence, it is now time to make up that mind.
Most definitely.
All right, let's see if we have any questions. All right, we don't have any questions. Let me see if we got anything going on in the chat room. Well, we got some questions, but they're not building on the information which that we're talking about per se. It's some information on which that was a little bit off topic in a sense, but it was more dealing with the Hebrew information. One of the questions on which that comes to mind was, whenever we mention the word Hebrew, it sounds religious. So I was breaking down to them that the ancient Kemetic or Tamarian or Tamarian word is actually Heperu, which means a priest of light.
Right.
And in Hebrew, the word Hebrew means to cross over. But what are you crossing over? What it's talking about is crossing over from the lower self into the higher self, from the lower aspect into the higher aspects of life. You know, of course, people will want us to believe that it's talking about the Tigris and the Euphrates River is what the so-called ancient Hebrews crossed over. It's not talking about just the land, the earth, but it's talking about your land, earthling. And so that's what people have to come to understand, is that these are allegories. And so when you cross over into your higher self, you become a high priest of light. Hence the word Kresmes, in which that becomes the word Christmas. But the word Kresmes means to be anointed, or to anoint the mummified body of our soul, which is the divine soul, to awaken the soul. And when the kundalini raises up through the 33 vertebrae, it awakens the soul, you know, into higher consciousness, you know, become the hero, or become the higher self, or become Christ consciousness. You know, this is what we have to understand, is that these are allegories. But when we begin to start breaking this information down, and this is the information, this is what people need, is that they don't need no longer fairy tales, they no longer need parables, and they no longer need any of these things, because all these things was done at a particular time period in order to basically not to cast pearls before swine. But we can no longer keep living in that type of society with that type of thinking, because too many people's lives are being ruined because of religion, because of the fragmentation and the friction in which that is going on between the various groups, in which that if I didn't know the information which that I know, in which that, you know, helped unify, you know, these particular schools, you know, I would just be as confused as the next person, you know, trying to figure out, you know, what I want to do in life. And so we have to help those who do not know, you know, how to come into higher consciousness, so that they can also be able to help uplift fallen humanity. All right, so let me see here. Yeah. Another question, it says, from West Africa to America, North and South Dakota. Okay, I'm trying to, all right. I think that's basically it. There was a question about Moloch, you know, and why do the elite still worship Moloch, you know, but they use a giant owl to represent Moloch. In other words, in the Bohemian Grove. Now, I'll answer that question, Brother Ali. It's real simple. If you go back to the original Tumerian or Metunata hieroglyphic script, you will see that an owl is the symbol for the letter M. And the mouth of Ra, which is called Ru, R-U, is the symbol of R. And those two together makes up the letters M-R, in which that vowels were not used at the time period. There were no vowels used. Vowels was something in which that was held as sacred, in which that when you came within 3 feet of the individual auric field by using a certain tone, these certain frequencies, you can set off a healing within their auric field. All right. So, like, for example, A, E, I, O, U, sometimes Y, those are the various sounds of the chakra system, you know. And so by pronouncing them, you know, within these particular consonants, and that's why the word consonant is actually extend from the word constant, and the word constant means that which remains the same. So the thing in which that changes the frequency of these words are actually the vowels. That's why it's called vowel L. Vowel means sacred or oath, and L means God. So it goes back to the same word as metuneta. Metuneta means, or metuneche means the sacred sound or the sacred word of God, you know, which is talking about actually Tahuti. So when you break this information down, you know, the owl is the symbol of the Moors. This is why the owl is on the right-hand upper corner of the left-hand side of the right-hand side of the corner of the one on the dollar bill. In which that you pull out a dollar bill and look on the right-hand side of the dollar bill, you see the one, and at the left-hand side box overlooking the top portion of the top left-hand portion of the one, you would see an owl peeping out from behind. And that particular owl is symbolic to the Moors. So Moloch actually is the symbol of the Moors, which is that giant owl in which that they worship at the Bohemian Grove. Now, the problem is that they don't tell you this because their whole objective is to keep you away from your Moorish heritage. And how we know this, because I've gone to the United Grand Lodge of England, which is one of the largest Masonic halls in the world, and the museum curator came up to us and he asked my wife and I and two other brothers who invited us over to London to do a lecture. And he said, well, how do you feel about the possibilities of your first black president? And before we can turn, you know, back to him and reply, my wife said, well, I thought there was more than nine before him. And he jumped back like Mike Tyson hit him. And he said, who told you that? You're not supposed to know that. Did they tell you that? So they worship us. All right? Within their Rosicrucian, Masonic, Shriner halls and lodges, they worship us. We are the greatest secret. That's the secret of Masonry, is us. As a matter of fact, at a 32nd, 33rd degree, when they become Shriners, is a known tale with the black Masons that they know the white Masons' ritual. They've been told somehow that that a child or a black man is part of the ceremony, in which that the white man is pale man is led up to the altar, and of course we know that these are fictions, but he's led towards the altar and he's blindfolded. And they pick up the blindfold, and he sees this black baby or man or whatever the case may be, and they tell him that this is the father of civilization. No, this is your God, basically. And so we know that this is some part of it. As a matter of fact, this is what drove Howard Hughes crazy. He wanted to buy his way into the Shriners. And so the Shriner took him down to the ghetto portion of the town. And he said, you see that bump? He said, yes. He said, well, that's God. That's your father. So, I mean, these are, yes, they worship us. So this is what is going on. Yeah, exactly. They worship us while they kill us also. But that's because of the blood sacrifices. Because they're trying to get the life force. You know, it's like the trying to put a soul in a soulless body. Okay? Brothers, y'all have any more, any things left to say? We got about 8 more minutes here.
Well, Islam, I just want to let all the Moors know that February 19th at 12 noon, Brooklyn, New York, Fort Greene Citizens, Senior Citizen Council Building, the address is 966 Fulton Street. We ask for all the Moors to come down And, you know, let's come together and let's get this thing right. So the Grand Sheik, Joe Bratton Bey, will be coming down to demonstrate the divine, the national side, as well as with documents to show the Moors that, you know, what we got to move as a government. We're asking for the Moors to come aboard and let's move together as one and do what we got to do as a nation. With that, I say peace.
All right. They want, within the chat room, they want to know what are your names once again also.
I'm Sheik Kareem Youssef Cornegay Bay.
And I'm Assistant Sheik, Brother Tunde Sadat Rael.
All right. All right, we definitely appreciate y'all for coming on. And, you know, anytime that y'all want to come back, y'all definitely feel free. Let me see here. We got some questions now, okay? We get ready to open up the lines, and we're going to go to 760, area code 760. You're on the line. 760.
Peace.
Peace. Yes.
Brother Tut, I have a question. Greetings. I had a question about the actual process of naturalization. I was checking out a YouTube video. I saw Grand Sheik in Chicago. He was breaking down how once you basically become part of the temple, how all of your debt, I guess you say vanish, once you become under the temple because of the 1099 our authority?
Yeah, Islam. That was true in 1928 when the Prophet was here, but after 1933, when the bank was the fraudulent bankruptcy took over with these adhesion contracts, that no longer worked. Because you had many more that's coming to the temple receiving nationality cards, but they not being classified and identified as being Moors with states, and nations. So that's not really practical in 2012, but during the Prophet's time, you know, that's what you had to do, is just come under his authority, and you was protected and recognized as being a Moor. But the international banksters, they upped the ante when they created this fraudulent bankruptcy, and started, you know, having all these adhesion contracts. So that method of coming to the temple and receiving a nationality card and, you know, coming out of the foreign jurisdiction is not going to work in this day and time. So that's why Grand Sheik Richardson de Gouel established the Moorish Bill of Vital Statistics for all Moors to register under, that is recognized under our own jurisdiction, and that we send documentation to all these states and nations to rectify your status as well as your attribute and title, so that do it within a system, be recognized as being a Moorish American, and as well with your noble title to your attribute. Because this is the divine and national movement, and the movement is progressive. So like the Prophet had, that was forced to make changes during from the old Canaanite temple all the way down to the Moor Sinai temple, we still have to make changes to this day because the cartel de Europe is constantly, you know, changing things all the time. So that's with that, I just say peace.
All right. We got another question here. We're going to go to 347, area code 347. You're on the line. 347.
Islam. This is Brother Kurt Thomas Bay, citizen of the Moorish American National Republic.
All right.
This is Brother Kareem Sheik. So when they said that, right?
Islam
was, like, somebody just spoke about religion. Like, they got to know that religion is law and law is religion. Prophet Noble Jolly set up, well, he brought back that old-time religion, and this is like a divine and national movement. And through this religion, like, what we are part of, we're Hebrews, and that was the Hebrew law. That's what facilitated our freedom, and we're protected. And if any of the brothers want to read section 1, if they have a chance, in the 1320, they'll see that. So religion is a very big part. This is a divine and national movement. So we have to have the two. Was that I said Islam and peace.
Islam, yeah. I'd like to elaborate what Brother Kirk Thomas B was saying. That's one of the citizens in our temple, is that we understand this world that we presently in is operating only on 3 degrees, which is, you know, in the Masonic degree is fellowcraft, enterprises, and master mason, person, place, a thing, man, woman, a child. But out of that 3 degree, we had a 7 to 9 degree system, so they operate only on 3 degrees. We as adept Moors know that, you know, it's way beyond just the Hebrew. We understand that it's higher science pertaining in there, like the prince, Alim El-Bey had demonstrated. But when you're dealing with this society, it's operating on 3 degrees, which is, you know, Judaism, Christianity, Islam. That's what they're dealing with, these 3 degrees. And we understand that religion is law and law is religion. So we utilize the religion to navigate in certain situations, because the prophet set up a religious corporation, what gave me this ecclesiastical body, what they have no jurisdiction over us. So even though religion came through the hands of a corrupter, we can't throw out the baby with the bathwater, because we still could utilize religion to navigate how we got to navigate in this day and time. So that's why the prophet said that our religion is Islamism, because under the black codes of Virginia, you was classified as a Christian. So the prophet said that your religion is Islamism and that you're Moorish American, and give you a title to this vast estate to take you out of that jurisdiction of those Negro codes and black codes that classify as a Christian, so you could be classified properly. Because a Christian was a term that was applied to the European nations, and a Moor was that applied to the Asiatic nations. So that's why the prophet utilized religion, or that old-time religion was called Islamism. And with that, I just say peace.
And Islamism is Sufism, as we would say, which is also more science, which is becomes Rosicrucianism, a Rosicrucian, which becomes also Freemasonry and Shrinism. All these are nothing more than our ancient mysteries, which is part of the ancient system, old-time religion, as we would say, of Sematawi, which is the science of the duality of the lower self and higher self, and the mastery of such. And by us mastering our various chakras, or the seven churches, or the seven eyes of God, or seven eyes of Allah, or the seven Elohims, as they also refer to within the 101 and 102, we are actually mastering self, you know. And the seventh chakra symbolizes that Michael or Melchizedek or that Muhammad seat, you know, of mastery. And so this is what we have to come to understanding of, you know. We have another caller here. We're going to area code 757. 757, you're on the line. 757.
Peace.
You
had
a question?
Yeah. I just want to, you know, shout y'all out, shout you out, Brother Aleem, and the guests that you got on the show tonight. I just wanted to say something real quick. When you had said about the, was going in on the masonry and some of the, sacrifices that, like you had mentioned earlier.
Yeah.
That was basically like what the lynchings and all the violence was about in the early, you know, like the early, you know, 18th and 19th, you know, centuries and all that.
Right.
Yeah. Basically, that's what that was. That was, And we've been like kind of led to believe it's like this whole hate thing, but it's basically that was so they could that was to help usher up the rise of the Caucasian.
Right.
Yeah. I just wanted you to to address that. No.
Well, it's the stealing of power. The ancient spoke about, if you go to the Mayan. If you go to some African cultures, Aboriginal cultures, some indigenous cultures on the planet, they speak about that if you eat the flesh of your enemy that you gain their power. So this is the same concept of the blood sacrifices, the human blood sacrifices, in which that correlates to such is the thievery of power. You know, and by the sacrificing of, according to John Henry Clark, he states that the numbers of the African Holocaust or the indigenous Holocaust ranges to over 250 million.
Yeah, that's incredible.
You know, so, I mean, that's phenomenal to me. You know, so that's what they're talking about.
Yeah, I could just, you know, studying the Freemasonry or just seeing how it's impacted the development, you know, of what they call, you know, this country. And, you know, it kind of it opens your eyes once you see, you know, how it's played out.
Right.
Yeah, but I just wanted to mention that, man. And the joint you played on the break, man, that was some fire, man. You went in on that.
I appreciate that. I definitely appreciate
it. Yeah. You did your thing, man. Yeah, I'm gonna be in the cut listening, man. Peace.
All right, thank you. All right. We got another question here. This is 678, area code 678. You're on the line.
No, Warren, I did not have a dollar. All right, I'm not producing
75%. Peace. 678, you're on the line.
You know, glasses look up through. I don't need to take a slow shower with my glasses. Get my glasses for free.
All right. All right. Brother Kareem? Sheikh Kareem?
Yes, sir.
All right. Can you please announce for everybody one more time here the dates, February the 19th, and what would take place?
Yes, February 19th. It's going to be at the Four Green Senior Citizen Council Building, Brooklyn, New York. The Grand Sheik Joe Bratton Bey is coming down to demonstrate the Divine and National side with documents to show the Moors what we have that we could do as a government. And we ask for all the Moors to come down and, you know, come to this monumental event with us so we could all come together as one. We ask for, you know, the Amir Todd Tariq Bey to come down yourself. Roz Mariah Bey, Grand Signature El-Bey, you know, all the Moors, Great Seal, Mexican Moorish Empire, everybody, come down, let's come together as one, and let's start moving as a nation, Moors. The Moor Science Temple's everybody. So it's going to be February 19th at 12 noon.
All right, everybody, hopefully you wrote that down. Is there any number in which that they can contact concerning it? You want to give out your number possibly in order for to contact for someone who might have questions?
Well, we have a website. It's called www.moorishamericannationalrepublic.com. And on our website, we have contacts. We could contact the Grand Sheik as well as other officials on that website. And, you know, you could get further information pertaining to February 19th. So that's www.moorishamericannationalrepublic.com.
All right. Definitely appreciate y'all for coming on. Man, I'm telling you, y'all dropped it. All right, we're going to have y'all back on again sometime here soon. So just keep us in mind, and whenever y'all ready to come back, just give me a call.
Definitely. We appreciate it, brother.
All right. Peace and blessings to y'all. Islam.
Islam.
All right, y'all, we're getting ready to close it out. We reached our time, and actually we've gone over a little bit, but we're going to still do our thing. All right, we thank you all for coming on and listening to us once again, and we appreciate each and every one of you, and hopefully y'all can spread the word and get more people to listen and, you know, get the numbers up so that we can definitely do what we need to do, and that is to uplift all of humanity.
First World Order Radio. Finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
there's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.